store for us for the next 3 weeks. And in preparation for Martin Luther King Day and for our Jan term on current events, our assembly speaker today is Martin Luther King III. As the oldest son of the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Mrs. Coretta Scott King, Martin Luther King III serves as an ambassador of his parents' legacy of nonviolent social change. A graduate of his father's alma mater, Morehouse College, Mr. King has devoted his life to working in the nonprofit sector to promote civil rights and global human rights and to eradicate the triple evils of racism, militarism, and poverty his father identified as the scourges of humankind. As a high school student, he served as a page to Senator Edward Kennedy and continued his public service supporting social change movements through speaking engagements, appearances, and his writing. He was later elected as a member of the Fulton County, Georgia Board of Commissioners, representing over 700,000 residents. As the elected president of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the organization co-founded by his father, Mr. King, reinvigorated the SCLC by stabilizing the governance, program, and development components. As founder and president of Realizing the Dream Incorporated, he took his father's message to a global audience, spearheading nonviolence training in Bosnia-Herzegovina, India, Israel and Palestine, Kenya, Sri Lanka, and the United States. As former president and CEO of the Atlanta-based King Center, Mr. King remains a member of its board of directors. In addition, he serves as a board member of Southern Christian Leadership Conference, Drum Major Institute, a New York-based think tank, and the Metropolitan West Management Asset Corporation. Mr. King has also served as an election monitor and observer in South Africa, Nigeria, and Kenya. In addition, Mr. King has conducted nearly 40 poverty study tours in a groundbreaking initiative, which has sparked public debate and law enforcement advocacy on the issue of poverty. In conjunction with Ambassador Andrew Young and other partners, Mr. King co-founded Bounce TV, the first independently owned and operated TV network featuring African Americans. The network's content includes movies, sports, documentaries, and original programming. The recipient of numerous awards and honorary degrees, Mr. King is married to Andrea Waters King and the father of a daughter, Yolanda Renee, named in honor of his late sister, Yolanda Denise King. So before we begin, Mr. King has brought us a quick video, and then we'll welcome him to the stage.
I've been thinking, yes I have. Some call it wishful thinking, I about the way this life could be. So much sadness seems like not enough gladness seems to me. Lack of vision is a dangerous thing. You can see it, then you start to feel it. The next thing you know, you believe, and that's when dreams begin to come true. So with all your heart and your soul, start right now, really take control. Turn our dreams into reality. And until you do, I'll be dreaming for me and you. We'll see together what a dream can do. And we'll discover how to make dreams real. Oh, hey, say, you know, say, if seeing is believing, then let the dreaming begin. Let the dreaming begin. If you can see it, then you start to feel it. And the next thing you know, you believe, and that's when dreams begin to come true. Oh, they'll begin to come true, say, whoa, so with all your heart and your soul, start right now, really take control. turn these dreams into reality. Oh, I know that we can change this world, but first you're gonna have to believe. Oh, believe, say yes, we can change this world, but first you're gonna have to dream. Everybody dream, turn our dreams into reality. Oh, say dream, everybody dream, turn our dreams into reality. Say, oh, won't you dream of a peace and dream of justice, dream of a healing, dream of love and dream. Everybody dream, turn our dreams into reality. Oh, say now, dream of a caring end, of a hunger, dream of a sharing with one another, dream. Everybody dream, turn our dreams into reality. Dream of a spirit, dream of a glory, dream of the ancient old, olden story, dream. Everybody dream, turn our dreams into reality. I want you to dream of peace and dream of justice, dream.
Good morning. Let me say, first of all, I am truly honored to be here to share today. I think this is my first time speaking at Westminster, I believe. I've been here many times over the years, but I am honored to be here on January 4th. I think it's your first day of school, right? Since the holiday? Is that right, or your second? Oh, you're okay. Second day. Okay. Before I begin, let me just say to President Keith Evans and Upper School Principal Cindy Trask and to one of your teachers who is responsible indirectly for getting me here, John Monahan, and to the teacher that is directly responsible for getting me here, Mr. Reynard Oliver. Honored to be with each of you and your students. Now, I have a special guest with me today, actually two special guests. One is a parent of a couple of students who are in your classes, and that is Mr. Bill Raglan. And all of a sudden, I had a senior moment. Also, my daughter, Yolanda Renee King. Yolanda, why don't you stand? So this morning, I hope to touch on the areas just a little bit that a syllabus that was given to one of the classes, and I don't know if the entire high school knows about the class, but maybe you do. The class, three of the issues that are focused on are politics, terrorism, and guns. Interesting topic. I want to talk a little bit, and I will touch probably on several of those areas, but I want to talk a little bit about where I think we are as a nation and a world community. Because many of you will become leaders in our nation and world, and maybe already leading as young leaders here in your school and as leaders for our nation in every area. Obviously, education is where we acquire our foundation. Certainly, much of that starts in our homes. But what we're exposed to helps determine how we see the world, and it helps to shape our existence. Now, of course, we're in January, so every January, we have an opportunity to observe the Martin Luther King Jr. federal holiday. This is probably around the 30th year of the federal holiday. It began as a federal holiday in 1986. President Ronald Reagan signed the legislation in 1984. And the holiday first began to be observed in 86. Now, that's not how it was observed nationally because, quite frankly, my father was killed in April of 1968. And in January of 1969, my mother and a team of people in Atlanta had begun to start observing the holiday in 1969. And then other cities and states came on board. And ultimately, over a period of time, every state passed the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. So today, we do have the federal holiday that we observed on the third Monday of every January. The purpose of the holiday is to really teach us about the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. and also, I believe, to help us have a better understanding of our nation and our world. And so every January, our nation is engaged in service projects for that 3 or 4 day period. This year, the holiday is on the 16th of January. And it's interesting because Dad actually was born on January 15th. So every few years, it falls on the actual holiday that he was born on. But usually it's somewhere between the 21st and down to the 15th, and it jumps back up according to leap years and all that kind of thing. So it's very interesting that there are times that we will observe the birthday on his actual birth date. Now, my father and mother, and as the video stated, dedicated their lives to what I would call was the eradication of the triple evils. Dad defined those evils as the evil of poverty, the evil of racism, and the evil of violence and militarism. And when you look at what's going on in our nation and our world, all of these things still are very unfortunately prevalent. But we can, in fact, reduce poverty. We can, in fact, eliminate racism. We can, in fact, reduce militarism and certainly significantly reduce violence. But we've got to understand what it is and what has created some of these issues. For we live in a nation that has a multi-trillion dollar economy. I mean, the federal government's operating budget is over $3 billion. And corporate budgets are another trillion. So when you live in a multi-trillion dollar economy, how do you justify 35, 45, 50% numbers of persons living in poverty? It really makes no sense. It does not mean that everyone should be rich or will be rich. But certainly everyone in America should have the best education. Everyone in America should have a decent home. Everyone in America should have health care. Everyone in America should have justice. Just a few things. And yet that does not exist. In this city alone, we have thousands of people who are homeless. And again, we look at every city in America, and homeless numbers continue to grow. Even though the economy may not be growing at anywhere near the level that it once was, we still have a huge economy. So why is it that we have impoverished conditions? Part of it is because we as a society have not focused on it. If we focused on eradication of poverty as we have in creating technology, poverty would have been addressed. If we focused on poverty, I mean, just a little bit, a few things we could do, and it would make dramatic change in our nation. And those changes perhaps would reverberate throughout the world. Because quite frankly, the world is abundant. And it all, some of it is a mindset. Some of it is what you believe. If you have a poverty mentality, good, bad, or indifferent, that's probably what you're going to get. So you have to see beyond your circumstances. That's very difficult for most of us as individuals often. But you have to see and realize that in the world there is abundance. There's an abundance. There's an abundance of opportunity. And then we have to find ways to create that abundance. Now, my dad and my mom in their lives, they did a number of things, and I want to share some of those because I was a small child at the time that radical changes were occurring in our nation. In 1955, my father and mother lived in Montgomery, Alabama, where I was born in 1957. My older sister, who unfortunately is deceased now, also was born in Montgomery in 1955. But in 1955, there was a major boycott of the city transportation system. And my dad was a minister at a church called Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. Today, that church is called the Dexter Avenue King Memorial Baptist Church. And in that pulpit, he preached every Sunday. And the community chose him to lead a major effort. In 1955, on December 1st, Miss Rosa Parks sat down on a bus. And she sat in the section where African Americans were supposed to seat, to be seated. You may not know this, or you may. But in that bus, the bus was divided in half. The black passengers sat in the back. White passengers sat in the front. If the white section filled up, black passengers were told to get up so that white passengers could sit down. Black passengers had to enter the front of the bus, leave, and then re-enter the rear of the bus to go to their sections. Oftentimes, passengers would deposit their money, get off the bus, and the bus would drive off and not allow them to get on. But on that day, Ms. Parks was sitting in the black section. She was asked or told by the bus driver to get up or they were going to call the police. And they called the police and she was arrested. That created a boycott of the bus system. So for 381 days, black people in the city of Montgomery chose not to ride buses. And after 381 days, when 60% of your ridership does not ride, you have what you call a serious deficit. And somehow you have to figure out how do you do deficit reduction. And so that boycott created a swelling in that community. And as a result, after 381 days, those buses were desegregated. And blacks were treated, the process began for blacks to be treated more fairly and justly. Now, as I said, my father was the chief spokesman for that effort, and Ms. Parks was the heroine of that effort. But he didn't stop there. A few years later, he and his team and others were involved, and first I should say, in 1957, the year that I was born, an organization called the Southern Christian Leadership was founded. My father became the first president of that organization. There were about 80 pastors that founded SCLC. In 1960, there was something called the Freedom Rides, 1960 and 61, and the sit-ins. Both of those movements were designed, one, to desegregate public transportation nationwide. Because in that day, blacks could ride Greyhound buses, but yet when you got to a particular city, there were separate, supposedly equal facilities, separate water fountains, separate restrooms, and they were supposed to be equal. Of course, they never were, but nevertheless, that existed. So blacks and some whites joined with those blacks to ride Greyhound buses throughout the South, to stop in these particular areas and basically desegregate those areas. Ultimately, that happened. And then, of course, the sit-in movement was a movement where students in Greensboro, North Carolina, it started, decided to go down to the downtown restaurants and basically sit and demand to be served. Of course, students were arrested, but ultimately that was addressed. And then in 1963, a number of interesting things happened that year. 1963 was a turbulent year. Of course, 1963 was a hopeful year also, because it was the year that my father delivered the I Have a Dream speech, where he shared his vision for our nation and the world. A vision of freedom, of justice, of equality, of truth. And also 1963 was the year after the March on Washington, which was August 28th of 1963. After that, there also was a bombing of a church, the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama, where four little girls had gone to Sunday school, and members of the Ku Klux Klan had placed a detonating device, a bomb, and that bomb tragically killed those young girls that were in Sunday school. And that was the latter part of 1963. But 1963 also was a movement of students. Interestingly enough, students have always been involved in change. In 63 in Birmingham, the students in high schools, and maybe even elementary schools, but certainly the high school students, decided that they were going to go to downtown Birmingham and march and demonstrate and protest. And at that time, it's a little different. But at that time, if you arrested children, that was just an awful thing to do. I mean, it was all right maybe for men to be arrested, maybe even women. But the 2,000 or so children in the Birmingham school system, I think it was actually over 3,000, many of those students were arrested. And of course, ABC, we didn't have but three major networks, ABC, CBS, and NBC. And they were all filming. So the whole nation was seeing the police department arrest children. And that was sort of unacceptable. That's what helped to create the climate so that in 1964, a Civil Rights Act could be signed by President Lyndon Johnson. The Civil Rights Act was signed in 64, and in 65, a Voting Rights Act, and in 68, fair housing legislation. In the 60s, very turbulent year, we lost a number of very prominent leaders. In the African-American community, we lost Medgar Evers, who was the head of the NAACP in the state of Mississippi, who was killed. We lost Malcolm X in 1965. We lost Martin Luther King Jr. in 1968. But in 1963, we lost President Kennedy, and we lost Robert Kennedy in 1968. So we lost five dynamic figures at a minimum who were known. And that was a very, very difficult decade because we were also engaged in the Vietnam War, where we were spending millions of dollars, and ultimately over 50,000 soldiers were killed in the Vietnam War. Well, that meant the 70s had to be a decade of recovery, I think. Because when you go through trauma, trauma can sort of wipe you out. That's what our nation was going through. And then, of course, the 80s became a different kind of generation because we elected President Reagan, and President Reagan brought in new proposals and new standards. And back then, you had something called the yuppies and the buppies and all these kind of things where you have your 1.2 kids and you live in the suburbs, and it was all about me as opposed to we, as opposed to us. You know, one day I hope we can get back to that notion of what President Kennedy talked about, asking not what your nation can do for you, but what you can do for your nation. But somehow we got on a track that focused on selfishness and self-serving. And it's all right for each of us to work diligently to aspire our own dreams, goals, and objectives. But it's also, I think, important to give back to the broader community. You know, my dad tried to teach us that, and my mom through her life as well. And yet, what they used as a philosophy was the philosophy of nonviolence, which teaches us to live together, not destroying person or property, and to resolve our conflict without using violence. Of course, that's a message that we still have not learned in our nation or our world, because our instinct is to deal with force upon force. It's just like the issue of terrorism. You'll never eradicate terrorism by terrorizing others. That just does not work. You saw the quote, "Darkness cannot put out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot put out hate, only love can do that." These are the kind of things that my father and mother preached throughout their lives. And yet they're even true today. So it's interesting where we now are in a space where, number one, we've been promoted to believe that our nation is weak. Not sure what that means when you have all weapon systems. Maybe the weapon systems need to be upgraded. But you have all these weapon systems. You have the capacity to destroy the world probably 20 plus times. And yet, your mentality is to go and build some more weapons. Doesn't seem to make sense. Certainly not logical. But yet, because we're in this global competitiveness nature, we feel like we have to create more and more, stockpile more and more, and threaten more and more. But threats don't necessarily work. When you treat people with dignity and respect, and as they are human beings, I think terrorism can be suppressed. I do not believe that fanaticism is addressed the same way. But certainly terrorism, we can reduce terrorism when we start treating people with dignity and respect. We live in a nation of 300 million people, and yet we consume a significant amount of the Earth's resources, far more than our population dictates. Now, of course, we've been responsible for producing a lot over the years. And so that may be in our minds the nature of why we feel that we at 300 million can consume far more than our share. Or maybe we don't realize that we're consuming more than our share. But somehow we have to figure out, how do we navigate through relationships, global relationships? How do we navigate when everybody has a gun? And there's nothing wrong with guns. I'm certainly a supporter of the Second Amendment. But there is something wrong, I think, when you feel that you need assault weapons. Why do we need assault weapons? I mean, a weapon that can put out 30 bullets in a couple seconds. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. Even if you're an avid hunter. I mean, is it fun to shoot an animal with 100 bullets? I mean, you know, that takes the sport out of it. I mean, that's not even fair to the animal. But the reality is, we've gotten consumed with guns in America. When I was at the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, we did something called a gun buyback campaign, where we would go into communities and repurchase guns. And in some communities, that lowered the homicides and other kinds of things. And as I said, I'm not against a person having a gun. That's your right. But I'm very concerned about the number of guns that we seem to have in our society. And I am very concerned about why there is the perception of an increase of crime throughout our communities. There's the perception, and then there's the reality. And the question is, well, why is that happening? What is it that we as a society are not doing that would cause a different behavior pattern? But when you don't have truly equal education across the board, we say we do, but we don't. I mean, all of you are very fortunate to be here at Westminster. Because our public school system is challenged. Not every school, but many of them are. You know, my daughter is very fortunate. She goes to the Atlanta International School. And then there are a number of other schools that some are able to go to. That's very good. But how are we going to create a higher quality of education at the public level so that everyone at least has the same perception of opportunity? Because what happens is, in many communities across our nation, there are no opportunities. Chicago is a classic example where you had over 700 tragic murders last year. So what is causing that other than a significant level of dysfunction? But when there's no opportunity, when there's not decent health care, there's not decent housing, there's not decent education, that is a remedy, a partial remedy for those problems that exist. But not just in Chicago, all over our nation. Now, you know, when I was coming up, we used to have music that was very positive. And I'm not against the music that exists today. I can't say that I understand some of the rap music. I don't understand it. And I certainly don't understand sagging. I mean, you know, if you're gonna sag, why not just don't wear no pants at all? Just, you know. I mean, when I was growing up, we in our neighborhood, we had to run from dogs. And because dogs were always on the loose. How do you run from a dog sagging? I mean, I don't get it. You're in trouble. You gotta be able to low run. But anyway, if you don't want to wear your pants, just take them off. You're gonna go to jail, but you know, just take them off. And then texting. It's a necessary evil. Now, I have to keep a kid with me because when I went to school, we were taught how to make our sentence structure and subject and verb agree. Now, I have to walk around with somebody sending me some letters, and I don't know what they mean. And so I have to have a kid with me to say, well, now, what does that mean? Tell me what that means. The reality is that's the way the world is moving. Instagram, Facebooking, texting, I mean, there's no telling what else is going to happen. But information technology is probably where much of the new jobs will be in terms of jobs that are viable where people can make decent money. And so we've got to almost retrain most of our workforce because we've got a workforce that is poorly trained and not capable of doing some of the high-tech jobs. Now, I believe we can do that. And I hope that President-elect Trump continues to focus in that direction. As you know, he did sit down and meet with a lot of the tech executives or CEOs just a few days back. So there are many interesting things that are being proposed. And I certainly believe we have to be hopeful. Now, politically, many of you were younger 8 years ago, very, very, very young. 8 years ago, our nation came together and elected its first African-American president. And what the leadership on the Republican side chose to do was to say that we're going to do all we can to make sure that you're not successful, meaning the president of the United States, President Obama. Now, interestingly enough, you've not heard any Democrat say that we're going to do all we can to make sure President Trump is not successful. In fact, what people should be saying is we're going to do all we can to help make our nation successful. We've got to come together. We are a nation that's divided. Over 50% of the population did not choose to elect the president-elect. But the president-elect is the president-elect, and on January 20th, we'll become the president. So somehow we've got to figure out how do we govern through this difficult period of time. Now, it really just takes a few good women and men to bring about change. My dad and his team overcame unsurmountable odds because the majority of America was not with what they were doing at the time. But yet he continued to push in a positive, nonviolent way to bring about social change, and yet it occurred. So I guess what I'm saying is, if one may be dissatisfied with where we are and what exists, we have to continue to challenge to bring out the best of America. What my dad did, quite frankly, was, this is a hypothetical example, if you were 80% evil, he didn't focus on the evil, but he focused on the 20% good. And he found a way to extract that 20% good out of you. And that's how he was able to achieve many of the things that he and his team achieved. And it also was a team. It was not an individual. Teams win. We know this through our sporting analogies. We know this through life. Teams win. An individual sometimes gets the credit, but it's a team that will create the victory. I was a little troubled about the election because Mr. Trump is an unknown commodity. I don't think we yet know what he's going to do. But I do think that even he wants to be a good president of the United States. And I think that we have to help create that climate for him to become the best president that he can become and the best leader of our nation. Why? Because that's what exists. That's the way it is. And I think that ultimately our nation can continue to be a great nation. But we have to be very careful. We shouldn't work to get into any wars. Hopefully we'll not be engaged in any more wars. We've already been engaged in wars where we spent billions of dollars. And if we want to say our economy is challenged, one of the reasons is because of the wars that we've been paying for all these years. One segment of the population, a very small segment, has made a lot of money off the military-industrial complex. But the overall economy suffers when we engaged in military pursuit. We've got to learn how to live in a more peaceful and humane and sane manner in our nation. My time is running out, so I need to prepare to close. But I know that you at Westminster, as a collective, each one of you, will probably work to achieve the goals and dreams that you have. And the majority of you will fulfill those dreams. Those dreams will become reality. But I also hope that as you achieve your dream, that you're thinking about, how do I help those who come behind me? You know, there's an old saying, the good politician plans for the next election, but the statesperson plans for the next generation. So we must be concerned about generations yet behind, coming behind us. And the way I kind of characterize this is, when I was a child, my mother took me to an undergraduate institution, Antioch College. And at Antioch College, there was a statue on the campus of the educator Horace Mann. There was an inscription on that statue that made an indelible impact upon my life. And that inscription said, "Be ashamed to die until you've won a victory for humanity." And you may say, well, my gosh, that's grandiose. How do you win a victory for humanity if you don't have a corporation, a multinational, a 500 Fortune corporation? Well, it's very simple. You see, you can win a victory in your neighborhood. You can win a victory in your school. Some of us may win victories in our places of worship. Some may win victories in our city. Some may win victories in our state. Some may win victories in our nation. And then there may be some who will win victories in our world. Those words basically mean, be ashamed to die until you've done a little something to make the world in which we all must live a little better than it was when you arrived. Thank you very much, and may God bless each of you always.